Today, I'll show you how to recreate the sleek, glowing magic of UK's Channel 5 interludes using nothing but After Effects and a little human creativity, of course. Now, if you're not from the UK, you might be scratching your head now. Those Channel 5's interludes are, as you can see, these elegant, quiet animations where parts of the logo pop in and out of the floor. And this is accompanied with glowing sides and subtle textures. It's a simple but oh so satisfying look. Now, we can't do the textures here inside After Effects, but the rest? Totally doable. Let me show you how. I'll start by creating a new composition. I'm using this preset, so 1920 by 1080, 25 frames per second. The duration is set to 15 seconds, and I'm going to name it Stern FX Glowing Logo because I'll use my logo to create it. So here it is. I have an Illustrator version of my logo. You can use any logo you want. And I'm going to right click on it and choose Create and create shapes from vector layer. Now I can remove this, and I need to separate the logo to the base and to the main logo. And this main logo is going to be animated up and down inside this shape, which is going to serve as a cookie cutter mold. Now, of course, I'm using a circle in my case. You can do it with any shape that works with your logo, but the process should be identical. So I'm first going to rename this one base, and then I'll open it up. And in the contents, you'll see that I have two groups. So this path is for the circle and the other one is for the S shape. I'll take this one and I'll place it underneath this path and I'll say goodbye to the group. Now, in my case, it works perfectly. So I have a compound path, or basically transparent, between those two areas. If you have more than two paths, then you may need to select the group, go to the Add menu and choose the Merge Path operator. Make sure it's under those two paths or more, and then open it up. And from these options, check Exclude Intersections, which is going to do the same. All right, I'm going to select the fill, click on it. I don't need the stroke in this case. And I'll change the color here to 200, 60 and 40. You can go with any color you like, obviously, but this is what I'll choose. Next, I'll duplicate this base, I'll call it logo, and then I'll open its contents. And from this group, I'm going to select path 2 and merge path and delete them. So now I have those two ingredients that I can work with. Again, this is just the inner shape and this is the outer one. I'm also going to make sure nothing is selected now and double click on the rectangle tool, which is going to create a shape at the size of this comp. I don't need a stroke for it, so I'll remove it. I'm going to rename this one background. And since I know it's going to be huge and I need it to be underneath all the layers, first I'm going to drag it down. Then I'll press S and I'll start by scaling it to 800. Now I'm going to convert all the layers to 3D and then I'll change the mode to the Cinema 4D renderer. Now, of course, you can use the advanced 3D renderer if you like, but I think the Cinema 4D renderer offers best and fastest results in this scenario, also much more cleaner shadows, and I'll prove it to you in a moment. All right, so let's begin by selecting those two upper layers, opening them up, and then for the geometry options, I'll change the extrusion depth to 60. Then I'll click outside, and for the logo, I'll change the bevel style to convex. And I'm also going to change its position. I'm going to raise it up. So I can press P to show just the logo position and change only the Z to negative 60. Now, it's difficult to judge what we are doing here. So what we'll need to do is just select a different kind of camera angle. And to do it, I'll hold down the Option key, Alt on Windows, and I'm going to move it like so. And it's still very difficult to see what we have here. So what we need is to change the side material. And to do it, I'll need to open up the group, make sure to select it, and then go to Add, Side, and select a color for it. And now we can see that we have a different color just for the side. I'll click on the color chip, and I'll change the color to 40, 20, and 100. So a bright yellow in this case. Okay. Now I want to do the same thing for the other shape. So actually I think I can copy the material and then I can go to the base and I'll select it and I'll just press Command V, which is going to paste it. But again, it is occupying the same 3D space as the background here. So we'll need to push the background down. I'll select the background layer, and for the Z, I'll just type in 60. All right, we are going somewhere. And of course, we can move between those different camera tools. So you can press C and maybe again twice and just zoom in so we can have a little bit of a different angle over here. This is something that will work for the purpose of just, you know, designing it. And of course, if you want to move faster, you can move to draft 3D. And in this case, I'm going to hide the ground plane and maybe also the extended viewer. So we are just going to render the shapes inside the frame. Okay, now we want to animate those pieces. So I'll switch off the background layer just so it will be easier to see what we are doing. I'll return back to the selection tool. And first I'll create timeline markers so I'll know where I need to cut. I'll make sure nothing is selected and then I'll type in 300 to go to 3 seconds and I'll drag my first marker, holding down shift. This is going to snap over here. Then I'll move to 6 seconds by typing in 600. And I'll do the same and I'll do it 2 more times. So 9 seconds, I'll create another marker. And the last one wants to be at 12 seconds. I know you guessed it. Now I'll select the logo, press P to show its position and change the Z position to negative 20 as well as create a keyframe. Now I want to animate the logo over 3 seconds, but every marker, I want to start a new animation so I can cut later between those animations using different camera angles. So what I'll do is I'll go to marker number 1 and then I'll move 1 frame backward by pressing page up. And over here, I'll change the Z setting. Let's go with negative 10. So again, a very slow animation going down. And then at 3 seconds, I'm going to start a new animation. So I'll change it to 10. And of course, this is going to just jump it, but it will look all right when we'll add the cameras. And then I'll go to 6 seconds, go 1 frame before and change this value to, let's say, 30. So now it's just basically going down. And then we can actually skip this marker. Let's create an animation between this guy and over here. So I'll go to 12 and then 1 frame up and I'll change it to negative 40. And then I'll go to 12 seconds. So page down to go to the next frame, change it to 10 and go to the end. And then I'll change it to 59, which is almost where the background exists. I don't want to give it the same value because I don't want them to overlap. Otherwise we may have some problems in the render. Right, let me show you this from a different angle and hopefully you see what I'm doing here. It's a little bit difficult to judge, so I think it will look much better when we'll add some camera and light. So let's start by adding a camera. I'll close everything, I'll go to the layer menu and under new, I'll create a 35mm camera and I'll click OK. And again, it's difficult to judge how this looks. So let's go back to the layer menu and add a light. I'll start with a spotlight. I want to cast shadows and I'm also going to change the shadow diffusion to 100 and maybe also the cone angle to 100. So basically everything is 100 except of the 50% for the cone feather. All right, I'll click OK and now we can start to see how this works. So what I want is just to put this light exactly above the logo. So somewhere over here. And we can also play with the point of interest. To better see what I'm doing, I'll go to the end and I'll add a couple of extra lights. So again, layer new light, I'll add a point light. This one wants to be 200 in terms of its intensity. And I happen to know where I want to place it in 3D space. So I can actually use the properties panel. I'll just type in 2000 for the X. Tab to the Y, this one is going to be negative 3000 and the Z is going to be negative 300. Now I'll select this light, I'll duplicate it, I'll double click on it and I'll change it to an ambient light. And this is going to become more apparent in a moment. The intensity should be 100% and I'll place it over here. Now again, it doesn't look like much, so I'll switch off Draft 3D. and then I'll select both the logo and the base. I'll double tap the letter A, so AA in sequence is going to show us both the geometry options as well as the material options, and I'll switch on cast shadows. And this already starts to look better. However, I'll close everything. We have too much ambient light. So this is where we need to override the materials. We want the ambient light to affect just the side of the logo, because this is what will make it shine and glow. And to achieve that, we need to change one setting for the side color. So I'll select the logo, I'll open it up, I'll make sure to open its contents, and then select the group. And again, it's very important to work like this, otherwise After Effects is going to tell you that it can't apply materials or override them unless they are inside the group. All right, so I'll go to the options here, and from the side options, I'll add this ambient only to the side of the logo. I'm going to do this again in a moment, but before doing so, I'll open up the material options, scroll down, and for the ambient of the entire shape, I'll set it to 0. And this means that we're only going to see the ambient light for the side of the logo. Since we are here, let's also change the specular intensity to 70%, and let's do a quick rehearsal, this time for the base. So again, I'll need to first open the group here, go to the add, go to side, and choose ambient. And then I'll need to close this group. We can also close the contents and the geometry options. And for the ambient, I'll set it to 0. And for the specular intensity, I'll raise it to 70. I think the background is just too bright, so I'll select it. I'll change the color. Let's just move it over here and try something different, maybe a bit more of a darker tone to complement the other colors. And of course, we can also open its settings. And for the material options, we can play with the specular shininess if we want, maybe bring it a bit more darker towards the 70s or 60s or 50s, depending on which decade you like. Now I'm going to take this camera, I'll drag it up above everything else, and then I'm basically going to split it to 5 different cameras and animate each one of them separately. So I'll go to the first marker over here, and then I'll press Command Shift D. You can also get to this menu by going to the Edit menu and select Split Layer. And now I'll return to this camera, and for the sake of speed, I'll switch on again Draft 3D. I'll hold down Option or Alt, and I'll move to somewhere close and interesting in this area. I'm basically using the 3-button mouse to orbit, pan, as well as drag into the shot. And if I'll switch off Draft 3D, you can see how this works. Now, to save us some time, I'll fast track through the other camera angles. The idea is the same. Orbit, pan, and track around until you find an interesting perspective. Something different from the last shot, but still keeping a bit of mystery around your logo. Once you've got your angle, you can double tap the U key to reveal all the modified properties. And now you can animate the point of interest and position to create some smooth, subtle motion for each one of those angles. And yes, I'm using my superhuman After Effects skills to make this all happening at a lightning speed. And then I'll preview it to see how this looks. And of course, we're still using Draft 3D, so this is not the final look. But if I'm happy, I can make it look much better by applying the glow effect. And we'll do it with 2 adjustment layers. So I'll go to the beginning, make sure, of course, to switch off Draft 3D. I'll create an adjustment layer. And to this adjustment layer, I can add the glow effect. I'll double click on the glow to edit it. I'll change the threshold to 80 and the radius to 50. So we'll have a massive glow going on. And then I'll change it from original colors to A and B colors. For color B, I'm actually going to use white, but for color A, I'll pick something orange, I think, which is going to help warm everything up, something like this. And of course, we are going to name it Glow 1 because we'll duplicate it and create another glow. This wants to be a bigger radius. So the threshold is going to be 100. I'll leave the radius as is, but I'll change the blending mode from normal to soft light, which is going to achieve this darker look, and maybe also lower the opacity of the entire layer to 50%. And what will really help to sell this is if we'll switch the color depth of the project by option clicking on it twice from 8-bit to 32-bit, which is going to make everything looks much more glowiness and much more interesting. And this is how it looks, as you can see, really lovely. Now, if you want, you can spice it even better. And I've cooked up a few color variations using the same composition. And just to make life easier, I've tied the colors and the camera Z rotation angles to an expression controller. This way, I can tweak everything with ease and create different variations. Next, I took each composition and dropped it into another comp, and then I've applied a 3D channel extract effect. I've messed with the black and white points, and boom, you've got a grayscale depth map. Throw this into another instance of the same video, but this time with the camera lens blur effect, and voila, you've got yourself a depth of field look that's pure eye candy. Once you've set up all your variations, toss them into the render queue, hit render, grab a snack, and when you're back, you'll have four or more shiny new logos versions ready to go as openers, interludes, or even fancy screensavers. So if this helped you out, you know what to do. For more cool camera tricks, check out the next tutorial on your screen, and I will see you again in the next one.